For this session, I left a lot of time for questions and trying stuff and discussion, because we are going to see a bit of Fortran also, not in detail or anything, but since there is another programming language, maybe it's worth to have more time for discussion, just in case. So now we're going to see F2Py. F2Py is a Fortran compiler, Fortran interface generator for Python, and it comes with NumPy. It is a command line. There is a command line executable that you get with NumPy, and also it works as a Python module. And what it does is to make easy for the user to write interfaces for Fortran in NumPy without too much effort. So we are going to do this one first, and then later we're going to do a CFFI. And with CFFI, we are going to do more stuff by hand, and then more or less you can have idea how magical is F2Py. Okay, we're going to move now to the notebook. Well, not to the notebook, to Jupyter. We don't have notebooks. And please just go to Python HPC F2Py. I just uploaded some updates on the scripts. So if you could do that git pull, you will get the last version of the scripts. Give you a minute to do that. Okay, anyone had a problem with the git pull? Okay, it seems it went fine. So here we have a readme that we can open if we do right click, open with Markdown preview. And we get here the instructions, how to build the thing. And what is what, but let's go to the terminal. And we have the distance F90. We are going to start with distance F90 here. And let's see first what we are doing here. So the thing that we're going to do today with F2Py is we have this Fortran function that computes the city block distance matrix, and the same for the Euclidean, right? And we're going to go to the function. It's going to be very simple. And what we're going to do is to create a NumPy a Python binding for it. We're going to create a library, and this library can be imported by Python. And then we're going to see how we can use this function that is written in Fortran within Python. Okay, we're going to do a wrapper. We're going to learn how to build it and everything you need to work with this, okay? So let's go quickly through the function. Here inside, before seeing the Fortran part, this is like any language, it would be more or less the same. You have two for loops. Remember that the distance matrix we need to combine all the vectors of the data. Actually, I can put here quickly the reminder of the function. So we have this. We want all the combinations, the distance of this one with this one, then the next row. And we get a matrix with all the possible combinations. No? And we are going to start instead with the Euclidean. We're going to start with the city block that, if you remember from yesterday, was a bit harder to make it fast, because the Euclidean one, we used this trick, and with that we got something already with NumPy very fast. Okay, so we come back here, and so we have these two loops that they just combine the vectors, every row of our list of vectors. And then internally we do another loop that just computes the city block distance. Okay, and here to make it faster and in parallel, we add some OpenMP directives that what they are going to do is parallelize these loops here. But don't worry too much about this, okay? If you haven't seen, of course, OpenMP. So this part, I hope, is clear. Please let me know if I have to repeat something here. But or if you want to say something, please unmute yourself if you can, and just ask. So this part is clear. It's just simple loops like any other programming language. And here is it's Fortran specific. Those are the arguments, the specifications of the arguments of the functions, because here in Fortran we have to declare everything. The arguments, we have x and y. X and y are this. This would be x and y, a list of vectors. Here we pass the number of samples, or number of rows that the data has, and the number of columns, because for the loop we cannot know, from the way we declare the function, we cannot know the size of the array, so we have to specify it explicitly. Okay, and this R is the put R of result is here, where we are going to save the distance matrix. Okay, this is going to be the input. This is going to be, we're going to write in this memory, we're going to write the result, the matrix that we want. And here we say for these inputs, we put the intent in, which is going to be input. These two, n samples and n fit, is going to be also input. And the last one is going to be input output. Input output, because later you will see that you have to pass it, and then you have to declare it first. You will pass it to this function, and then the function is going to write it. Okay. Now this is, I think, everything we have down, more or less the function. I hope everybody understood. Otherwise, please raise your hand or unmute or just write the question. Okay, so we have this function. This is the first part, and now we want to use that in with Python. For that, we use F2Py. Come here. F2Py can be used as a command line or as a module. If you use it as a command line, you can run this. This command here, you have f2py minus c, the function that you want to pass, no? That would be this one, minus m, the name of the library that you're going to create, and here some flags for the compiler, and this one is comes with the, because we're using minus f openmp, it's just a linker flag to link to openmp, okay? Pretty simple. If we don't need any specifics, only this part here is enough. So let's run it. Oh, that's nice. I'm sorry. I forgot to go inside of the folder. So here we see the compilation. And we got this this library. So this library is a, if we do LDD, so LDD will give you all the libraries that this library is linked to, that is needed by the library. And we see that is we have Python is using libpython 3, so it's already, we can import it directly in Python. We have well, many things from the system. We have OpenMP because we use this flags here. We have OpenMP. Everything looks fine. So and now we can run it. But so the way I set up the scripts, we have to put it inside of a folder called metrics. CBDM means city block distance metrics. So we have it here. And now let's see if it works before city block. Okay, it works. So here from this output, you can already see more or less, one is the function that we already did in Fortran. One is CDist, the one we used yesterday, just for comparison. And the difference is 10 to the minus 13. So everything looks fine. Now let's see how we can use this function that comes from here, okay? So this is the example, the code that is going to run it. So here we have time, but it's nothing to do with the script. It's just to measure the speed. NumPy, SciPy, nothing to do. So this is the first thing that has to do with the script. We are importing like any Python packages. We say from metrics CVDM, import CityBlock distance matrix. We come here. CityBlock distance matrix is the name of that we give or in Fortran to the function. And CVDM, if we exit, is this part of the name. So you don't import it from CVDM.scipython, blah, blah, blah. No. You just use from metrics CVDM, import this the name that you gave in Fortran directly. And now the first thing that we have to do, here we create some data. And the first thing that is particular for this example is that we have, if you remember, there is an R here that we have to pass, which is where the data is going to be stored, where the distance matrix is going to be saved in memory. We are going to, we need to create that, to initialize that. We give we create an empty NumPy array. So this is an empty of this shape. Empty means that it allocates a memory of this size for the NumPy array, and nothing is initialized inside. Just whatever was in the memory, when you read it, it can be any random thing. Okay. And very important is this part, order Fortran. If you remember yesterday, we have this thing, we have the metadata and the memory, and we said that the data, when you create a NumPy array, is stored in C order, which is row major. Row major means this. If you create an array from a list, from this list, for instance, it's going to have this order, it will save the memory like this. It will go, if your array looks like this, it will go first the row 0, 1, 2, 3, 0, 1, 2, 3. Then it will move to another row up to 7, then to another row, and so on. In Fortran, it's in the other direction. If you save it, if you want the data, if you save the data like this, it's going to look like that. It will be something in this direction. Something saved like this in Fortran will be taken as 0, 1, 2, 3. So this is going to be here. You will have first the columns and then the rows. So you will go first the column, 0, 1, 2, 3, or the column, then next column, and so on. Okay, is this clear? Should I explain again? So this is the difference in row major and column major. And then that's why we have to specify order Fortran. Because if we don't put order Fortran, something like this, when Fortran reads it, something like this, Fortran will think that is this. While actually what we want, sorry, that is this. While actually what we want is this, okay? Then of course everything is going to be wrong. Okay, we said order Fortran. The default, we never put it, but it's like this, order C. And then how we run it, this is our function. We here just put some time to measure. This is our function. And then we have X transpose and X transpose. So why we're putting X transpose instead of X? Well, because of what we talked about before. This X here is something that we generated that we are going to run it with in Python. We're going to run it with other NumPy functions. So we cannot create it with Fortran order. Because, oh, we can, but in general, we don't do it. It's something that's going to be shared. So we declare it as normal. So we did it in C order. But if we pass it like this to Fortran, then Fortran will try to read it in column major order, and then everything it will have problems. The memory is going to be accessed wrong. Okay, so we pass the transpose. So we pass it twice here because we want X with respect to itself. So we pass the number of samples from here that we also could have got from here directly if we do the opposite. With the number of features, columns and rows. And we pass here our empty array that Fortran is going to write there. So the function is going to write in this thing. Then we run it. When we run this function, the thing is going to be changed. And then we will get our value. And then the next we do here is just to compute with CDs the same thing, and check that the values are the same. But there is some question here. There is an important thing that if some of you are Fortran users, Fortran programmers, may have noticed. So here we passed NumPy array, and here we also passed NumPy array. But there is a big difference that this one, we pass the transpose, which we already know that the transpose only changes the metadata. The memory is the same. And here we pass expecting that the memory is going to be written. So is there something that may sound suspicious? Okay. Then the thing is that when we have intent in and intent out for F2Py, this it's it going to treat it different when it creates the binding. So if these two variables, two arguments here, they have in, F2Py is going to assume that you are going to pass, just you only care to pass the value of the arrays. And then this thing is going to be passed to the function by value, not by reference. So what are you passing here? You're passing is the value of the array, not the memory. If you do transpose, you're passing whatever is the result of the transpose. And for this one that has in out, since it has as an out, it will assume that you will write something there and it's needed after the function returns. So it will pass the memory. So for this variable, the function has access to the memory of the function. And for these two, the function has access only, sorry, to the memory of the variable. And this one has access only to the value of the variable. So these two, you are not, well, I have never tried to write it. I don't think you're supposed to do it. Probably you will get an error from F2Py, but you shouldn't write it. No? This one will be, it's going to be assumed to be passed just the value. That's why you don't have to change the memory when you use functions that come from F2Py. And this is something very handy because this would be involve copying the memory, changing the transpose by hand, many steps more. And F2Py makes this very simple for you. Okay? So I changed something here. Okay. So let's run it and we can have a look to. We can put another terminal here and see and put top. So we have top here. If I put top minus, okay, less things. If we look here, you see we have a multi-threaded because we use OpenMP and comparing to CDIST is very fast. And in my opinion, the effort, the speed up that you get for by the effort that you have to put, which is write this function that is not particularly complicated, you don't really need to know too much Fortran, is huge. So you got here about seven times faster for only writing a very simple thing and running a command line. Okay, this one, let me check some questions. Comments. This how you use it in normal, in general, in Python code, in your if you make a package or something, is that you wouldn't write the whole package in Fortran. You would write only the functions that are heavy, that are expensive to run, that you cannot run it with NumPy, or even with NumPy they are very slow or consume too much memory. That kind of thing, that part of the, that bit of the code, you can speed up with Fortran using F2Py. This almost for free. And now let's have a look. Oh, we can do the same with the, I don't know, before I haven't built it. I prepare also for the Euclidean distance matrix. The thing is the same. And now let's have a look to something else. Let's have a look to this thing here, setup.py. Before we use this command to build, and then we created a metrics by hand and we pasted everything there. But if you have a package, as I said before, and you are optimizing or implementing in Fortran to get better results, parts of the sensitive part of your package, you wouldn't use this by hand or all these commands. In general, you use a setup script. And let's see how it works. So F2Py also supports building through these utils. And then instead of doing from this utils core, you would do from NumPy these utils. Remember that F2Py comes with NumPy. How this works, you have something there called extension. An extension is going to be what every of the things. This one is going to be an extension. The Euclidean matrix, every function that you do in your program is going to be an extension. Okay. So here you can define the same flags that we did in the command line. Linker flags. More options, verbose to print more stuff while it is building, the Fortran, the language that you want. And then you define the extension. So we have one extension, which is Euclidean distance matrix, and one extension that is ctblock. The API, this is very simple. You pass the name, you pass the file that you want. If this is somewhere else, you pass the whole path to it. And here you put the flags and everything that we define here for both of them, language, options, and the same for this one. Then at the end, you have all these extensions, and you get setup, which is the other thing that we imported. Here, this is the function is going to run the building itself. Here is just declaring. You call it the package metrics, or however you want to call it, and you pass the list of extensions. And to build, I also paste it here. So here by hand, and then so build X means build extensions and minus I in place. Paste it here. Actually, we can delete metrics and the whole thing, so you see the whole process. So we start from nothing. Everything is built, and at the end, you get this. This is the stage directory where everything is built. There you get the whole thing. We're going to go to it now. You see something C and F. And you get metrics with the thing that you built inside. Okay, here we got both at the same time. And that's the idea. When you have a package with many of those, you put them on your setup, you run the whole thing, and that's it. Okay, let's have a look to this stage directory now. Probably I can delete the thing. Oops. So we have C things here, and we have wrappers, and we have a lot of stuff. Here, this is, if you look at it, it's kind of a header that this is what we had, and it adds some F2Py stuff. With this F2Py stuff, he takes care of things like processing the arguments and saying which one is by value, which one is by reference, and more things that we're going to see in a minute. And we have this one that is C. So what is doing this thing here? This is actually what's doing the whole glue from Fortran to Python. So Python gives you this, which is it gives you access to the C API of Python and allows you to write extensions. So this one you cannot do directly in Fortran. And then what F2Py does, well, amongst other things, is to create this C wrapper. And by using the Python C API, it writes the wrapper for your function. So in total, what you have is your function, a wrapper for a Fortran wrapper for your function for F2Py, then a C generated source for the binding, and that the whole thing is what how the code travels from Fortran code to binaries that can be used in Python. Okay. Questions? Remarks? Comments? Okay, so this one that we saw here in distance F90 in this folder, we saw is like the basic usage. There is a more specialized, which is we have it here in distance so this is Pythonized. This one looks more or less the same. Everything is the same, except the function, the Fortran functions itself. So we will have now in the So this one is Pythonized. This one is the one we already saw. In the Pythonized version, what means Pythonized? F2Py can do, besides these things with the arguments and creating everything for you, it can go even further. If you, in your Fortran declaration, specify specify the shapes of everything, so nothing is decided at runtime. Like here, compared to this one, we specify the shape of X. We specify the shape of Y, and you see here that is the opposite than in NumPy. NumPy we have n samples, n fit, and here we have the column major order. So we put the opposite. If we put this, then F2Py will be able to guess what is output and what is input, and we create a direct NumPy function that you can use like any NumPy thing. You will see now what I mean. Let's go to distance Pythonized. So if we do these things, now this one we don't need. Now, so we import the same, but look how we are calling our function. So we're not creating the empty array. We don't pass the shapes. Everything is guessed by F2Py, and it even gives you a return from the function. The first time he couldn't guess it because the shapes were not specified, but now he has everything squared, and it gives you a Fortran a NumPy function like you would normally in Python things are used. And what it does here, you still can pass the whole thing, but it gives you the rest of the arguments as optional arguments with name. So you can put the whole thing or you cannot. And then you get a little bit more of a Pythonization, let's say. Okay. So this one, you can write it in your code like this, but not always is possible, because sometimes you prefer to leave things to be decided at runtime. In this case, it's very simple, but other case not. And sometimes you have functions that you got from another code, you just copy and paste it somewhere else in your file, and you add it to your packages. And you don't want to change this function. You just adapt your Fortran code your Python code to this Fortran function. Okay. That's it. If somebody have questions, please. I gave you here an exercise. You can work on it if you want now, or maybe I think I would suggest it more for as a homework. The exercise goes into different possibilities, like this opening. Sorry. So we have this Fortran function here. Fortran source, sorry. And you see something is missing here. The arguments are missing. The argument, if you saw, is the relevant part of the fact that it's in Fortran. Otherwise, the rest is. It's almost like pseudo code. There's basic loops and some small details. Okay, so you have to add the arguments, and here the exercise tells you to do two implementations: one using signal precision floats, which is called real in Fortran, and one using double precision in Fortran. And how you deal with that. I give you here the solutions. Oops. Okay. I cannot exit Vim. Okay. So. Here you have the solutions, the code, how to build it, and the test. If you want to work a bit on that until the end of the session, which is at 2, and then the break. Otherwise, if you have questions, I'm going to be around. This is more or less what I wanted to show. So please. Okay, there's a question. Is there an opposite way in which you can call a Python function from a Fortran program? I don't know. I'm sorry, I don't know. Somebody, anybody in the audience or you guys, the panelists, somebody has heard about this? Apparently not. And maybe we can talk a bit about the memory of the memory that you locate inside of the function, because in the session of Theo there was a question about the gill and the garbage collector and the memory in extensions, in C extensions. So here, so if you go to things talking about GIL or garbage collector in Python, they always mention that threads or memory created here inside is not accessible by Python. So in short, this all the things exist in Python, but for instance TMP Python doesn't know that TMP exists. So there is no way that it's going to get deleted or changed, but unless you do something bad. Otherwise, these things are completely independent of Python. Same thing for the threads. So these threads are independent of the threads that are locked by the GIL. So Python runs, let's say your program runs in a single thread and you don't do multi-threading in Python, which is very common in I don't know, for many packages like NumPy, for instance. You don't do multi-threading in Python. You have a single thread. Then you call this function, like in this. If you go here, in this same very example here, you have a single thread. You configure, you declare your variables, everything in a single thread. You arrive to this point, and then the OpenMP threads of Euclidean distance matrix in Fortran start. Python doesn't know what is happening at this moment. These threads are independent of the GIL and of Python. Then these threads join again. The function returns, and Python continues this thread without knowing everything about it. Okay. Of course, through the in this thing that we saw here in the stage directory in build. Through this thing, so this one is generated, but you of course can write your code using Python H. There you can interact with Python. You can release the GIL from this API, and you can do more advanced stuff. But in general, your threads and everything that you write in your Fortran code is not related to that at all. Okay. I think in C at the very question. I think in C at the very least one can call Python with something like system Python script or related and Python. Okay, this is related to the previous question of calling inside Fortran or in this case C another something from Python. Okay, thanks, Francesco. Okay, Luis, there you go. You have some idea where to start. I've never seen it before. So, okay, more questions? Okay, if not, I'm going to mute myself and I'm going to be here. If you have questions or something, please. Let me know. Sorry, well, I was muted. We go to the, we have 15 minutes of break. We come back at 2:15. See you later. Okay, welcome back. Before the break, the last minute, Tim told me that was muted. So I was explaining a bit the solutions. I'm not very clear. It's not really clear if it was muted the whole time or not. Anyway, the main point on the solution of the exercises is for the case of the single precision. So this is if you use real in Fortran, then your Python function has to, your Python example has to pass an array of type float32. So by default, the arrays are, when you create them like random, for instance, you get a float64, right? Single precision, you need MP float32, okay? The rest is pretty much the same as we saw in the other example. Okay, now, now we are going to have a look to the same problem pretty much, but we're going to create a C function, and we're going to do an interface for it to Python. Okay, so now we're going to use CFFI to do that. CFFI means C, foreign function interface, and well, it's pretty much what it says. It allows to create interfaces from Python to C, and it can be used in a few different ways. You can use it. It can build code for you and create the interfaces, or it can do interfaces to code to libraries that already exist, already built. It's very powerful. Today we're going to see just a few basics of it. I'm going to close all these all things. So we come to a Python HPC CFFI, and we start. So we have the README that explains everything. So we're going to start with the code version. Here we're going to do exactly the same thing we did with the other one, but it's a bit more involving from the programmer side. CFFI code version. We have this C function that we wrote. It's a very simple thing. If you look again, this part is pretty much the same thing that we saw in Python. Two loops, changing the, going over the rows or the combination of rows. And then inside, an inner loop that does the city block distance, okay? It's pretty simple. And the complexity, if you don't know C, is here in the declaration and in the way we run the arrays. We operate with arrays, because if you see here, we have A and B. A and B is the input. Should be the, we pass here the arrays. We have R. R is the same that we did in Fortran. We created the variable that Fortran is, it was wrote there, the result, and then we extracted it in our NumPy program, sorry, in our Python program. Here, this is the same thing. These are the input, and this is the output. Here is where the function is going to write the result, the distance matrix. And again, we have to pass the number of columns and the number of rows because here from C we cannot know it. Okay. So we have these two loops and the loop. Okay. So let's go to how we are going to use the function first before seeing how we get the Python version, same that we did with F2Py. So this is our test. Again, we have time, NumPy, those are utilities, SciPy for comparison. And our important thing are this one, from CFFI import FFI, foreign function interface. And this is what, when we will be, the library is going to be imported like this, but we haven't seen that yet. So we regenerate some data, we create the input file, and this one, you already know what is it, is the output. Here we're going to write the output. Then we create this object here that will allow us to do some utilities, because we don't have here F2Py, or there is not something like C2Py that it will do the binding for us. We have to write a bit of code to do the bindings, but it's very simple. So we get this object here, the foreign function interface object, and the first thing that we have to do is, if you remember from the yesterday and today earlier, the NumPy arrays have these two things: the memory, the data buffer, which is the memory block where the data is stored, and remember that this stored in C order, and the metadata. And the metadata was used to give some interpretation to this block of memory. So this block of memory, if you remember, it's a continuous line of memory. There is no notion of 3x3, or in this case, 4x4. It's just everything is continuous. And this is the same way we're going to deal with it in C. So as it's a continuous block of numbers of memory that doesn't have a shape. For that, since this is the way we deal with it in C, we have to extract from the NumPy arrays the data buffer. So we don't pass the whole NumPy array as we did with F2Py. So we pass only what C needs. And C needs is just the data buffer, which is, again, the great part, okay? This. So how we extract it? Like this. So X is a NumPy array. We do X, C types, data. That will be the data buffer, okay? The first thing we do with this data buffer to be able to pass it to the function is to cast it, which is to convert it, to make it to be of the same type of that the function is expecting. Here, the function is expecting a pointer type. We're not expecting a floating price, we're expecting a memory address, no? This is the meaning of this. But if you don't know C, you can see that it's expecting where this memory, the data buffer, which memory block, where is it located in memory? How did he can find it, okay? So we do that. Actually, we can put this side to side probably. Okay, it's better. So we do this. Now, this XC is the data buffer casted to this value, okay? And this is what the function is expecting. We do the same for the result. We cast it to double star two. Okay, this is fine. And now we run the function that we don't know yet how to build, but we run this function. We pass XC, so the input. We pass the variable to save the result, and the number of samples and number of issues, rows and columns. Okay? This function is going to run over it. If you look here, R and also A, there are no two indices. It's just a single index with some trick to convert it in strides, something like that. But the idea is that we have just a block of memory. It runs, it writes the things in R. After the function finishes, it will change RC, okay? This guy here, R. It's going to change RC. And since RC, the memory of RC was changed, the memory of R, which is the same thing, they share the same memory, is going to be changed. So you never call, you never pass directly the NumPy variable, the variable itself, to the OSIF function, but the OSIF function is going to change the memory because you gave the function where the memory address, where the memory is. And that's it. Now we do we compare and we check the results. Very simple. Okay, some questions on this part? Okay, now we can build it. To build it, we just run this script. You see here, it runs some GCC command. It created something. And at the end, he created something else. And at the end, we see a name of a variable. And you see here, some variable was created. The name of the variable is underscore CD block, CPython something, but this is the name, this part here is the name that we care. When we, if we look to our test script, we said from ctblock, from the thing, dot lib, that is something, this is the way it's saved inside of the library, import cvdm, which is the name of the, that we gave the function in C. Okay? To here so simple, and now we can run it. So we know how to run it. We already built it. And as you see here, we added some OpenMP directives. So this code is going to be parallel. It's going to be multi-threaded. So we can have a look if it really is multi-threaded. Let's do top minus one. And run it again. We look here, okay, we have 288, 400, okay, it's multi-threaded. Okay, that's it. Some questions up to this point? So now the missing piece is to see how to build, how to build the function. So we did this to build it. Oh, sorry, this is running. With this to build, what has this thing inside? So it's very simple. We again create this object here, the foreign function interface object, and we read the header of the function. So it didn't open it, but the header of the function is a. Put it this side. Here you specify in the header what the function returns. Nothing. It's a void function that doesn't return any value. And the types that the function expects. Okay. We pass the header. And we pass it. We open it like a normal file. And we give it to the fread. We will give you the content of the file in a string. And we give it to ffi_cdef. We do the same thing for the code. We open the code and we give it, this is some variable that we're going to use later. And we create this thing. We give a source, set source, So the first thing is we put the name of the library that we want. So this is this name here that we obtain, cd block. We put code, which is what we read in this variable. It's just the code. And some compiler flags, same thing we did in gfortran. We also can do minus -03 for instance for optimization, but this one I didn't put it because it's already f2py, sorry, cffi, the compilation already has it, and so I just added these two, and those are, this one is a link. Then you set the source, you have the header, and you just do compile, and that's it. That's it. You get your library. You get the library, okay? And how the compilation happens, some things are created here. You see this one, we already know, the library. This is the compilated version, the compiled version of this one. And this one is something that was generated by CFFI. You see it has the same name of the library. So what we open here, we have this guy again, python.h, okay? And that is already, you can know from that, this is a wrapper to our function. If we go down, we see our function was included here. This is exactly this one. Just copy inside and created all this. But from all this amount of code, same as in Python, in F2py, you realize that this is doing this by hand can be very complicated and error prone. So these tools like SFFI and F2py come very handy and very useful to create the C bindings for Python. Okay, and that's it. There is a this is with this one. This is the one I call code version here. The other example is lib version. Well, questions? The other example is a lib version. Instead of passing the reading the code and giving it to Python, sorry, to FFI, here we are going to give it a library that is already built. Okay. The way it is run is exactly the same file. What changes is how you compile it. The function is the same, C function is the same. The only difference is here. So here we create the foreign interface object. We pass where the library is. This part is just the current directory, probably it's not even needed. Where the header is, sorry. And you pass it, so this line here is identical. You pass the header to the foreign function interface. And now in the source, we are not passing code. We're passing a library that is supposed to be compiled at this point. This part here is the library is going to be generated. Fine. Here, since we pass a library, a binary object, we need to pass this include to make it to tell them that this is the header that comes with the header that is needed for this function. We give it the name that the library we are going to pass. We call it city block, it can be any name. and here what it is. It is in the current directory. Okay. Once everything is set, compile, and you get your library. How this works? So I created this makefile here. This makefile does the whole thing together, but here, if you want to go step by step, you have how to build the library that you need, and then just run the same thing that you did before. This one just does the same thing, but in a single shot. So we can run it. Make how is it? PyLib. That's it. So here we build the library. And now, before that, we only had the source and the new library. If we look here, we have the source. So the source that we have, the wrapper, the library that we built before, that is what is passed to CityBlock, what is passed to the foreign function interface, to the source, and the final library. Here, one important thing is that this first thing. So if we do this, make clean. Everything is clear now. If we just run this one, we get this library. But this library is not importable in Python. You cannot say import CityBlock. If you do nm, this library is off, and then you grep for any Python thing, there is nothing inside. But the final library that is produced by CFFI that is importable in Python it has Python symbols that are needed for to be able to Python to import it. Okay, also if you do the same thing that we did before for F2Py, do LDD, you see that this one has Python stuff there, while the other one doesn't have any Python thing inside, okay? So this is the library that you pass as source, and this one is the library that you will import in Python. And if we look at the wrapper right now, we look for CityBlock distance matrix. So we have this header here, but this code here, we don't have it because we never passed the, for CFFI, this code doesn't exist. What he cares is for this library, okay? And this is very, very, very useful because sometimes, you have some developers, they ship only a library, something already pre-compiled, or a system library that you want to call from Python. You know the internals, but you don't have the source. You can go and run it with CFFI. And there are other ways to wrap libraries with CFFI, but we're not going to see it here. But some of them you can load the library directly, not even need the header, and just fetch stuff from inside. But those are more advanced uses. But in the documentation, CFFI, if it's useful for you, it's very friendly, and you will learn a lot from it. Okay, questions? Here, same thing. If we have OpenMP, this we already saw that it runs multi-threaded. And these threads are independent of the Python threads. So if a single thread of Python call this function is going to create threads. They're going to join. The function is going to exit, and the single thread of Python is going to continue without knowing what happened here. One thing is that if you do something like this in, let's say it's not multi-threaded, but you want to run this C function in Python threads, so you don't have this one, and you have, you want to create Python threads to run this function, same as we did with Dask to parallelize CDist yesterday. This function probably, unless CFFI is doing something smart by default, but I don't think so, they won't be able to run in different threads of Python because we haven't said anything about the releasing the guild. So if you run this function many times in different threads of Python, most likely it's going to run in a single time. Okay. Sorry, in single time, synchronous, sequentially, one after the other. Well, one question is C++ work. C++ doesn't work. It's not supported, but at least until the point I prepared the slides. But you always can create a wrapper, a C wrapper for your C++ function, and like that you can call your C++ function. So you can do the same, similar to the same this operation. You build your C++. Function or your code, and that one you wrap it by a simple C code that calls that function, and that you can wrap with you can do the binding with CFFI. Same thing for CUDA C. You can write your CUDA code. You wrap it with a C simple C function that just calls that that code, whatever you have there, and that you pass to CFFI. Okay. Other questions? Okay, now in the rest of the time, I can give you 10 minutes, and there is an exercise if you want to play a bit with this and see the code in more detail by yourself. Here we have an exercise that is to create a wrapper, so Python wrapper for your function. So here we saw that to call test city block, we have to do some things that are not very Pythonic. If you give this to, you prepare this in your package that you are developing and you give that to a user, this is not very Python thing to create an empty array and do all these castings and then call something in the memory. So this is very strange Python wise. So the exercise is to simply create a wrapper, so a function that you're going to give, you're going to call it cctblock x, y, same as cdist. You pass two Python things, and then it's going to do everything necessary to call the to use the Python the C implementation. Okay, and like this is how you should give it to in general to a, for a nice API to hide it for a user all these parts of creating memory. Okay, So I'll give you 10 minutes and then we discuss the 5 minutes before to 3 p.m. and then we move to the Q&A. Okay, let's have a look to the solution. Am I muted? No. Let's have a look to the solution. So here we got something like this. So it means pass x and y and return this value here. We already have the city block thing, the C code is already done. So what we have to do is to create ourselves here inside of the function, the empty array, call the foreign functions interface, do all the casting. Here we do it twice because the user may pass two different, not only x and x. We run the function. This function modifies RC and we return R. No RC because in general nobody is interested on the block of memory only. General users of a function may be interested in the NumPy, in the whole NumPy array, okay? And that's very simple, okay? Now it can be used like this. If you give this in a package, it's very simple to use because you don't care about all the internals of the how to call this different function come from C. We just say cct block xx, and that's it. You have it running, and you don't have no idea that it comes from C. Okay, something like that is, of course, with more sophistication, is how NumPy and SciPy code is done. Okay. So questions. Well, now we can go to, we can, I give it back to Tim, and we can start the Q&A in 3 minutes. I'm going to stop the sharing. So Tim, you're ready?
Okay. So we've got an hour, folks. Rafael and Theo are online. So it would be, if you have any questions, it would be great to hear from you. Anything that's been covered in the last couple of days, and any burning questions, burning issues that you have, or just general questions about high performance computing and Python.
Also, if any one of you has some question, he can we can unmute and listen to you live, so that it's more interactive.
Yeah, stick up your hand, and we'll unmute you. You can also talk about how the pace is going, what's missing, what you've enjoyed, what you know. These types of questions as well. It doesn't have to be necessarily technical questions. It's the first time we've done this course remotely. So of course, there's always, you know, it's a little bit different from being in person. Well, it's a lot different. So any feedback's useful, technical questions or not? Don't be shy. Okay, we have a question. Great. Thanks, Giordano.
You want to talk about it, Theo? Or...
Yeah, so in general, it depends. Sorry if you can hear some noise in the background. I guess you can hear it.
No.
Okay. So it generally depends how much effort you want to put in the procedure. So Python gives you many possibilities and it has many options. So you can totally control what is generated and what not. Also, it has this very nice thing that it for the C++ container types, it binds to the corresponding types that work nice in Python. So it has its own, if you pass a vector as the example I showed previously, it maps to a list in Python. If you do it with a map that the standard C++ library provides, then it will translate to a dictionary in Python. And also many of the libraries that are basically Python wrappers for typical C libraries use Python. So you have a lot of control. Okay, and then how do Python and Python do this?
Continue, please.
First the CFFI, or I will answer this because it's Python related also. So as you saw in the example that I showed, when you manage malloc and free on your own, you are completely on your own. So if you don't handle the free by yourself, then you will have memory leaks. While on the other side, if you use types like the containers of the standard C++ library, they're fine. But as long as you're starting doing manually the memory management, then Python does not have a way to know, and Python cannot know what you have allocated manually. There are some things that you can do for this, but in general, it's not recommended to do this. So if you do manual memory allocation, you have to do the deallocation as well to make sure that everything is deallocated.
Okay, but I meant the other way around, like will the garbage collector cancel out, like delete my memory without me knowing? Like not that I have a problem managing it, but on the other side, will Python destroy it without me knowing because I forgot, like reference, I don't know.
Yeah, so for example, for the vector situation where it's completely handled by C++, it will call its destructor when it's garbage collected. But in the case that you have created an object by yourself and you haven't override the dialog on your own, it doesn't have any way to know. So it won't deallocate, you will have a memory leak. So as long as an object is alive holding a reference to that, it will not deallocate. But as soon as it does garbage collection, it will deallocate also the things that belong to that class instance. So that's why even in the case of the Mandelbrot in Python, I allocated the NumPy array outside. I called the function so that I have the allocation outside of the function, not done inside.
Okay, put in another way, can I have an object that is permanent between, like, I can go back to Python and come back again to C, and that object in C is still there. Right, let's put it this way. Or do I have to make like a global object, like for all this lifetime type of global object that's reliable?
I guess that if somehow you can have a pointer to some data, then this will not be deleted. But you will have to keep somehow the pointer so that it's not garbage collected. The data will not be deallocated, but you will have to keep the pointer somehow to move around. So I can see also into. I remember that I was looking into it, and there is a way to get the pointer back. But yeah, in general, you have to completely know what we are doing to make sure that it plays well with how Python handles things with memory.
Okay, thanks. I look into it.
Okay, there is another question with Dong, but before I want to add something in the question of Giordano about CFFI, that is a point that CFFI make, which is if you come from C, CFFI allows you to do the binding to run C within Python, and you don't need to know a third language. You don't need to know Cython, or that's it. You do whatever you know in C, what you know in Python, and there is a very simple way of doing the mixing. And that's one of the advantages that for me the CFFI side has. Okay. And in the question of Dong, I don't understand very well. I don't know if I understand very well, but in principle, the allocation. So when you write a malloc or when you do allocation inside of your C function, this is in the C side, and I don't know. I don't see why FFI would interfere with that. At least in the kind of examples that I show. So the malloc is not something that is done with FFI. So it's done in the C side. FFI is just doing the binding. But if you mean something, some more advanced use of FFI, that you do the lock within Python, that part I really don't know. But in our example, as I said, that shouldn't be a problem because it's done in the C side. Does that answer the question? Or are there more questions?
So regarding the memory allocation question, I have a part from a book that is dedicated to Cython, to how to do correct and automatic memory management with Cython and CRAs. And for NumPy's documentation, for example, it says that you, let me find it for you and I will paste it under the Q&A, because it's this thing that I have talked about, that when you do memory allocation outside of Python, then it doesn't have a way to know and the extent of the memory to and to deallocate it after, because this is done in the in C. So somehow you have to do some specific actions and to make it aware that you have allocated somehow this amount of memory.
Did we miss the last bit of what you were saying there, Theo?
Yeah, so basically there are some memory profiling tools that I guess can give you that, but I don't know if this can be done in Cython also. Let me check one moment while Tim, you can answer Camila's question.
All right. Okay. So yeah, Camila, I would say all sorts of computations at CSCS. So we provide services for all of the universities in Switzerland, and also we have allocation through PRACE, which is the European-wide computational science, large-scale computational science program. And then we also provide computational cycles for international as well. So it's a very broad range. If you look at some of the applications that are running, it's quite a lot of material science. So we use codes like CP2K, Quantum Espresso to do material science. We do biology. So for example, classical molecular dynamics using applications like GrowMax. We do sort of weather and climate simulation. So also at CSCS, we actually do the national weather forecast for Switzerland. So they use this code called COSMO. And so a lot of physics as well. So finite element analysis, computational fluid dynamics. It's a very broad range of science. It's all open science. So we don't do any restricted work. It's pure fundamental science and computational science in general. We have two calls for proposals every year, so every 6 months, and so you can apply to use our facilities through those calls. And we also have sort of development projects and preparatory projects to kind of get you up and running to be able to use the big systems that we have here. You can find out a lot of the stuff on cscs.ch. Whereabouts are you based, Camila?
So I'm pasting in the Q&A in the answered at Francesco's question for the memory management. I'm typing a link that is from Cython documentation regarding the memory allocation. If you want to make interoperability with NumPy, then you have to check also the NumPy documentation to see how it's handled, because there is a kind of protocol for the arrays there. And I checked, and you can use C profile to annotate your code in Cython, but for memory I don't know anything. Maybe you can do with the general Python tools, but I'm not so sure.
Okay, thanks. Let's check it out.
About the profiling tools, I don't know. For that, I think one needs some kind of profiler, some sort of profiler to see the memory. But I don't know if there is something specific for Python but I don't think so, that has like more features for Python. But in general, with any profiler that you can see the timeline of the execution, probably you can see the how the memory is destroyed. Now, to see the details, who destroyed, if it was a garbage collector or something that your C program did, that I think that depends on the, I suppose, on the tool you are using. If you are a CSCS user, on the user lab webpage in profiling, you will see there is a list of tools that you can use there. And in the main profiler that I showed yesterday, that you could see, but it's very high level. I don't think you can. It's line based, and I don't think you can see what is happening inside of the functions. And if it's something that's called C, it will give you the total memory that increased, or how the memory if it killing something after the. After this bit of code, this part of code is executed. So what is happening inside, I don't think you can see.
Yeah, I posted the URL in Francesco's answer regarding how to debug or how to check for memory allocation and deallocation. I posted the link from Python Wiki, for Python Wiki, and to that you can use Valgrind with to check for memory leaks. But for memory used, I don't know. Maybe you can use the memory profiler that if you have with Python. But again, I don't know if it's going to be aware of everything.
I mean, I'm pretty sure you can use a standard profiler like Google, GPF, Gprof, sorry, and then you can filter out Python functions, and you should see if you have C functions, you probably can filter them and see them in the profiling of the whole program. Like you provide the Python program executing the script, and then probably you can filter out your functions. I think I did something like that once, but I don't really remember.
Yes, it is tricky in general, and it's better to work with what it has. Only if you know exactly what you are doing, you should do that with the memory, and make sure that it works, it plays nice with a garbage collector, and that Python is aware and somehow deletes the memory. So wrap it in a function object somehow, and if you need, you can keep it alive for however how long the Python program runs, and then deallocate it. So any other question? I can go and show you for 5 or 10 minutes some other thing from Numba if you want.
Maybe you can show hands if you're interested. Yeah, people are just very shy. Sounds like it. Sounds like you should do that, so yeah.
Okay. So what I didn't have,
yeah, go.
What I didn't have the time to show was that we saw. Let me share my screen first. Okay. Okay. So. Yeah, we didn't have the time to show. I saw the number vectorized thing, but this works only for more or less for matrices or vectors that have the same kind of dimensions. But number allows you to do also what it calls generalized U-functs, which work according to the broadcasting rules of NumPy, so that you can use it. You can use a proper vectorization, which will give you a compiled native code for functions that can work with arrays of different sizes as well. So when I mean different sizes, I mean that you can have a 2D matrix and a vector, a 1D vector, and make them work together. But keep in mind that this, you have to be a little bit familiar with how the broadcasting rules work so that it doesn't surprise you. And also there's a slight, convention on how this GU vectorized is used. So imagine, for example, that I have a vector and I want to add a constant value to this vector. So my normal number vectorized would not work in this case, because the one is 1D and the other is just a constant. So it would not work. So now this is where the number GU vectorized goes. So this is the convention that it uses. You put all the things that are related to the function as arguments. And the last thing that you pass is the one that the function is going to return. So you don't see a return here like you would see in the vectorize, but you should pass it as the last argument. You will see how I use it when I use this GU vectorize when I call it. So the first thing that you pass is more or less the type of these functions, of these arguments. So here, notice that there is no zero dimension array for the U vectorized. You just have to pass it as 1D, and just instead of using ZI or XI or CI, use the zero for the one that is meant to be constant. And the other thing is here a convention of how this operation is going to be translated. So here what I tell I'm telling Numba is that it accepts an input array. The first argument is an input array of dimension M. You could put whatever letter you would need here. And then I have a zero dimensional array, which is more or less a constant. And the result is an M dimensional array. So you have a 1D with a length of M. Notice that M, as I said, is just a symbol here. It could be whatever, but it would have to be the same with the symbol that it's going to produce. So here I tell it that I have length M, which is a 1D array, a zero rank array, which is more or less a constant, and it's going to produce an 1D array of length M. So this is here how I write it. And just to show you how it works, here I create an array with from 0 to 9, and I just add constant 2. So the first one is the original array, and the second one is array 2. Okay. Now we can work with more combinations of dimensions for other arrays. Here I reshape my array to a 2.5. So my original array is this one. So it's 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, up to 9. First row, second row. And then I add a constant to it. So this works fine because of the broadcasting rules that NumPy defines. And now I have the array which has number 2 added to each of the elements. So you see that the first element from 0 became 2, the second one in the first row became 3, and so on and so forth. The 5 in the second row, first column, became 7. Now I run another thing, another example here, again with the same X array, and I have a Y array, which now is a vector. So I have a 2.5 array and a 1.2 array. And what's happening is that this works fine according to the broadcasting rules of Python. So now NumPy is going to take the 1.2 vector and add it to every column of the original array. You see the 1.7, the 0.5 here, by adding the 1.2, it becomes 1.7. By adding 1.2 to 1.6, it becomes 2.8. By adding 1.2 to 2.7, it becomes 3.9, and so on and so forth. And in the same way, you can have more complicated examples, like, for example, the matrix vector multiplication, which here, again, we know that the first input is a 2D array now. The second input is a vector, which is a 1D array. And the output, which is, as I said, the last argument that it should take to the signature, we should pass to the signature, is again a vector, a 1D array. And now we tell it the classical matrix vector convention that I give it an array M by N, my vector is N, and the resulting array now has a length equal to the rows of the first array. So I define it like that. And as expected, now I have the matrix vector multiplication here. I multiply my array, which is this one, with 1.2.3. So we get the first row multiplied by 1.2.3, which is 8, the second one 26, and then the other one 44. What happens now when I do it with a 3x3x3 array and multiply it by a vector? So imagine here that I have an array which is now a 3D. So imagine like it has three pages where each page is a 2D matrix. And I want to multiply with this vector. So it will take each page of this 3D matrix and it will multiply it by the vector. And this will be the first row, this matrix multiplication with the vector. This was the first row of this one, if you remember. Then the second matrix vector multiplication will go to the second row, and the third matrix vector multiplication will go to the third row. And now the more complicated example that I'm going to show is the matrix-matrix multiplication, where now I have two input 2D arrays and one output array. And you see here that this is the classical rule that we must obey for matrix-matrix multiplication to make sense. So if I have an M by N array multiplied by an N by K array, and the resulting array has the times of rows of the number of rows of the first array and the number of columns of the second. So these are just symbols, but they have to match the output that you are going to give it. So again, here I have the arrays, which I multiply the one I do with matmul that I have defined, and the other one I do with NumPy, and it works fine. And it will work also with different matrix dimensions, but that conform to this. So you could have a 3D and a 2D array, but the corresponding dimensions have to be compatible. So GU vectorize generalizes the notion of U function by taking into account the broadcasting rules of NumPy. So I just wanted to let you know that this is something that is also available. Any questions? No? Anybody wants to unmute and ask something?
No.
Okay.
Okay, sounds like probably everyone's tired and
yeah,
had a long day. So maybe we can wrap it up.
Yeah, just keep that in mind that you are not limited to just 1D arrays and the vectorize, but you can extend it to work with more complicated stuff.
So tomorrow we'll start again at 9 o'clock. We'll focus more tomorrow on utilizing the GPU. So we'll again look at Numba, but this time with the GPU. And then I think after lunch we'll turn to CuPy.
Yeah.
Which is another.
One other thing that I forgot to answer was a question that was asked before. How do you see which C compiler Python uses? So I looked into it, and basically you can, it depends on the environment that you have defined in your system. Like it's going to be based on how you do the compilation. If you do it with these two tools, for example, like with a setup script, it's going to use what is defined as CC or CXX. So it's going to use the system what is defined by the environment of the system that we are running. So you can basically point it to a different C compiler to use if you have some other compiler. but it's possible anyway to change the default behavior, so to change the compiler. So for example, if I have Visual Studio in my PC, because I have Visual Studio, and I want to use GCC or G++, for example.
Yes, you have to point Cython. When you compile with Cython, you generally do it either with CythonEyes or with these two teams, with a setup script. So there you have somehow to change where CC points to, so that Cython knows which compiler to use.
Okay. Yeah, I think you can
environment variable.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. The capital C environment variable.
Okay, okay. Yeah,
I was talking about.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, so Cython just does the intermediate job. The actual compilation is done by the compiler. So the compiler is based on what you want to give.
Okay, so basically it's just a configuration.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
So you can point it to which compiler it should treat as the C compiler for your system. Of course, in that case, if you want to pass compile flags and things like that, you may have to change because different compilers accept different things.
I think in general, the default see, all the definitions of what is C for Python, you can find it in your installation of Python inside of lib Python 3.6, let's say. And then there is something inside called sysconfig data. And then they have the list of all the variables. And in general, you just change the variable, not there, just in the environment. And then like that, you should be able to change the compilers and the flags and everything that you want to change.
Yeah, so it says here, I see, for example, in a Stack Overflow, there is a question like that, and they just tell him that in your setup script, just change for that script the OS environment CC to point to a different compiler. So just for that setup script, it will use the other compiler. So you don't have to make the change permanent in your system per se.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, so last call for questions. Then we'll call it a wrap until tomorrow.
Anyone wants to make a comment of if we are going very fast or we are going very slow or we are just fine?
Okay, so thanks Theo, thanks Rafael, and thanks everyone for joining in again today. And we'll see you at the same time tomorrow, same place. And until then, have a nice evening or night or morning, depending on where you are. And we'll see you tomorrow.
Bye.
Thanks everyone. Bye.